That's not gonna hurt your fingers.
No. No. Maybe he's gonna people's way.
Do you want me to take a bird? I can see right on this little.
I wish I could see something.
Lead, and we're gonna sing and praise God a little bit this morning. Oh, let's do it up first.
That we have to meet in this place, and while it may be a little unusual for some of us, God, we know that you are everywhere. Wherever we gather together in your name, you promise to be there in a very special way. And so, Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are here in this place to hear our prayers and to minister to us. We thank you, Father, for your love that keeps us safe, your love that keeps us warm and fed, and your love that keeps us in your care. Your tender hands. We especially thank you for your love that's been demonstrated to us in so many ways, but especially through your Son. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that while we may come from different places and different backgrounds, that you can unite us together. And so we ask that you would do that today as we come together to express our thanks and our praise and to also speak to you about needs in our lives and the lives of people around us in this world. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for each and every person that's here today. And we ask that when we have gone from this place, that we will know that we've been in your presence and that you have touched our hearts and lives. In your holy and precious name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen.
We don't have a set standard format this morning because we come from so many different backgrounds. So what I'd like to do to start off our worship, well, we've already started off by praising God and speaking to him and asking for his presence here. We also, I'm just sort of painfully aware because I have friends and family in Florida and along the eastern seaboard in western Florida. And I'm also aware that you have friends and family and others back home that may be in need. And so what I'd like to do, if we could do this in some kind of an orderly way this morning, I'd like to just ask for prayer requests. If you have a request, something that's on your heart this morning that you would like to bring forward, if you would just raise your hand and then just let us know, please. West Palm Beach, and
I don't know if I am. Right now I have home. Then I asked the Lord to give my home, my son that's there.
West Palm Beach, and she's not sure if her house is and her home is there. And we pray that God will keep her home and her son safe. Please.
I pray that my family in Boca Raton is safe.
Family in Boca Raton, we pray for safety. Yes. Broward County, family, extended family, safety and security, please.
For me and family all around Florida, so just pray for the whole intersection of Florida.
Yes, indeed. All of Florida, please. Brothers and sisters who are in Haiti and people of the islands who have been hit very, very hard, please. Mm-hmm. Traveling mercies for all those who are here on this ship. We pray for guidance and direction for those who are in charge, the captain and crew, and Becky and others who are serving. Please.
My granddaughter, Leah, in California.
Granddaughter. California. Pray for that God will just bring a calmness to this tropical season here, please. Any other prayer requests?
I pray for peace in the world.
Peace in the world, yes.
And for my nephews back home and their families, and good health to my friends.
Yes.
That I get home safe, and everybody.
Indeed. Peace in the world, safe travel, and please. Those of us who have children and or little dogs that need protection, please.
Pray for the crew. I mean, so many people that we talk to are away from their families. You know, so long.
Amen.
Yes. The prayer is for the crew and for their families. Many of them are separated for months at a time, and so we want to lift them up.
And I pray for the whole state of Florida and for all of us here
to
get home safely.
Yes, indeed. Well, while God can hear an infinite number of prayers at the same time, I can only remember a few. So we'll lift them up to the Lord and we'll do the best to cover those. But you understand that prayer is more than just what I say. Prayer is what you've just spoken, and it's the desires of our hearts as they're before the Lord. So let's join our hearts together. Father, all of these requests you have heard. You've heard them as we've spoken them with our lips, and you have heard them as we've spoken them with our hearts. And God, you have an answer for each and every one of those prayers. We lift up to you, Florida, and we ask that your hand of protection would be upon the places and the people of that state. Gracious God, we pray for family and friends back home who have anxious hearts for people in Florida, for us, and for others. We ask that you would give them calm and peace. Father, we pray for the crew aboard this ship, and for all those who have served us so well, and we ask your blessing upon them, upon their families, and we ask that you would keep them safe, keep them wrapped up in your loving arms, and as they're separated from family, we ask that you would comfort them. Our gracious God, we pray for children and family members who are back home. We pray that they'll be safe until we return and beyond. Gracious God, we pray for situations in California and throughout the world. We place them in your hands, Lord, things that need your touch, a touch of healing, maybe a restoring of a relationship, maybe a restoring of a body and a soul. All of these things, Father, we leave in your hands. We know that you are Lord of creation and all things are under your dominion. We don't presume to question you or challenge you about the hurricanes, Father, but we do ask that you would calm the natural forces and that you would alleviate the weather patterns and just give the folks a break, Father. We ask that you would do that. All of these things and whatsoever else you see that we have need of, we lift up to you in the name of Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you. We ask, Father, that you would answer these prayers, even as you answer the prayers of your people. Lift it up to you in his name, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Would you mind just coming and leading us in one more song, my friend? Into this flower garden where he has the boys sit in a circle and he says, and he recites a poem to them. And I wish I had a little bit of an English accent, or a Scottish accent, but the poem was something like this: "Gather ye rosebuds while ye may, for the time is but a flying. The flowers that you gather today, tomorrow will be dying." And then he says to the boys, he says, now that phrase, this poem was originally written in Latin, he said. And that phrase, "gather ye rosebuds while ye may," was originally the phrase carpe diem. Danny, you don't know what that means. Boy shoots up his hand. He says, yeah, it means seize the day. And he says, okay. And why do you suppose he wrote that? And now the boy shoots up his hand. Because he needed his homework done. No, that's not it. So he says, why? Because you need to seize the opportunities. The opportunities that are here today may not be here tomorrow. And tomorrow, you may be pushing up daffodils. All these boys are all confused. He says, come follow me. And he runs down across the campus and into this big, long building with all these trophy cases in the building. And their trophy cases are filled with pictures of classes that have graduated years and years before. And he pulls up in front of the trophy case and he says, as the boys gather around, he says, do you see any similarities between these boys who have graduated before you? And the boys go, oh yeah, they're wearing pretty much the same uniforms and same haircuts and similar looks. And he goes on to say, yeah, and they had similar aspirations and dreams and goals and so on in life. And he says, if you listen real carefully, they're whispering to you from the trophy case. So the boys are craning their ears up to the trophy case. And he says, carpe diem, carpe diem. Seize the day. Seize the moment. Then he says, you know where these guys are right now? And they said, no. Oh, they're all pushing up daffodils. So then he runs out and they continue on. Seize the moment. Grab every opportunity that comes your way in life. And that's why I said yes to doing this worship service this morning, because I had no idea what to expect and neither do you. So seize the moment. And that's kind of where I want to go with you today. Jesus said this, I think my rabbi is pretty smart about life. He said this in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5, verse 16. He said, let your light so shine before people that they will see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. And I'd like to just give a little spin on that this morning. I think part of that is living such an extraordinary life that people will see the radiance from you and be pointed to the extraordinary God who has filled your life with that kind of radiance and that kind of extraordinary seizing of opportunities. And that's, I just want to share with you this morning 3 points, and they'll be brief, I promise, Pauline, I won't go on all morning. 3 points about marks of an extraordinary life. The first point that I've seen, and I've seen some people who have lived extraordinary lives, and so have you. And I'm talking about some of the people, the names that you would recognize, the Mother Teresa's and those, the Martin Luther King's, and those who you would recognize as extraordinary lives. And I'm talking also about some of those people that you see every day who are leading extraordinary lives. And then I want to see if maybe it has some application for us here today. Living extraordinary, marks of extraordinary lives. The first mark that I've noticed is this. Oh, and by the way, as if you brought your Bibles with you, you can turn to Philippians chapter 2. I always encourage people in my church to take their Bibles with them wherever they go, because you never know. And so if you have your Bible with you, you can turn to it. I'll be reading from the Gideon version here. We need to talk to Mr. Gideon, because he keeps making the letters smaller and smaller every year. Philippians, and we're in chapter 3 and verse 12. Paul says there, not that I have already attained or I'm already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Then he goes on to say, brothers, I do not count myself to have apprehended it already, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Paul was really kind of talking, I think, about the marks of an extraordinary life. And the first mark that I want to share with you is this. Paul says, not that I have already obtained, and then he goes on to say, reiterate again, not that I have completely apprehended. In other words, I haven't completely arrived, and neither have you. Anybody who thinks that they have arrived at the fullness of their fullness of life probably never will. If you think you've already got it all together, all of your stuff and is all together, then you probably will never have all of your stuff together. Paul says, not that I've already attained, but I'm moving toward that. Okay? So the first mark of an extraordinary life is this. The willingness to set the bar a little higher every day. The willingness to set the bar a little bit higher every day. How many of you are thinking about things in your life on this vacation that you can improve when you get back home? Anybody? I'm thinking about a lot of things like that. Mostly for my wife. But setting the bar a little bit heavier, but a little bit higher. We all have things that we can improve in our lives. Did you know that in the workforce, just think about your job, for instance. On the average, in any occupation, about 20% new knowledge comes into your occupation, your field, every year. I think in the medical field, the knowledge doubles every 2 years. And in computer technology, it's like every 18 months, 100% new knowledge comes into that field. Well, at the very best then, if you don't change anything about yourself in your occupation, in 5 years from now, you will be absolutely obsolete, right? If 20% new knowledge comes in every year, okay? So, that was really good news. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to bring that to you this morning. Changing, setting the bar, the standard a little bit higher. I doubt if there's a person in this room who would not recognize the name Mother Teresa. Mother Teresa prayed a prayer written in her autobiography. I wish I could quote it word for word, but some of the part of the prayer went something like this. Lord, today, starting today, help me to do something for you, because up to this moment, I've really accomplished nothing. When I first heard that, I thought, oh my, how can that be? And then I started thinking about it, and what it really reflects is in her life, that sort of cutting edge of her heart that wants to expand, that every day wants to set the bar a little bit higher. And if you've noticed on this cruise line, the bar is set a little bit higher, and they keep setting it a little bit higher. And if that happens in our occupation, in our lives as workers and as people in this world, how about our spiritual lives? Could the bar be set a little bit higher? Could we attain for a little more love and a little more peace and a little more joy and a little more self-control and all of those things in our lives? Could we set the standard a little bit higher? When I was growing up in Sioux City, Iowa, I had a fellow who was a year ahead of me in school, Fred Thomas. Fred Thomas was this big black guy, about 6'3", just a real muscular cut and build, and he was kind of my idol. Football, baseball, basketball, track, and I tried to do everything that Fred did. Now, there was one event that I could not do nearly as well as him. Many things, yes, but not this one event. Can anybody guess what it was? No, not basketball. That's High jumping. Fred could jump, and I could not. No jokes. Fred could high jump. And about the time, and I'm going to date myself here, about the time that we were learning to high jump, there was a fellow by the name of Fosbury, I think, Dick was his first name, and he had developed this style of approaching the bar. Instead of going over face first, he turned and went over back first, and he would kick his legs up at the end. And Fred just perfected this technique, and he would kick his feet up just at the last moment and clear the bar. And he just kept going higher and higher and higher. And pretty soon he got up to 5'10" high jumping. Now, I am 5'10", and I always thought, you know, if I could high jump 5'10", I would just stop right there. Because if I could high jump 5'10", I'd get somebody to take a picture of me high jumping 5'10", and I'd build one of those little shrines in my home, and I'd have people come in and take a look at it. I would have stopped, but not Fred. Fred went on, and he jumped. He was 6'3", he jumped 6'3", and then he kept going and kept going. My point here is this. When he was jumping 6'3" and beyond, or 5'10" and beyond, and 6'3" and beyond, he already had 6'3", 6'6" inside of him. He just needed to push himself a little at a time to bring that out. Now, here's my application. Some of us are spiritually and relationally and emotionally, we're jumping about 10 inches. And but we think we're really doing well because, well, nobody else in my office is like that or anything. And God is saying, come on, raise the bar, the standard. If you want to live an extraordinary life, part of that is raising the bar and a willingness to do that. The second thing that I noticed from this text in Paul and from some lives that I've seen that I think have been lived extraordinarily, and that really follows right along the heels of that, because you've already asked yourself the question, well, what happens if I knock the bar off? Well, what happens if I fail? What happens if I don't make it? What happens if I don't succeed at this time in my, at this part of my life, whether it's a relationship or a spiritual growth issue or some other area of my life? What happens if I set the standard and I knock the bar off? Well, listen, friends, you're going to knock the bar off more times than you're going to clear it, right? So the second mark of an extraordinary life is learn quickly from your mistakes. How many people in this room, due to some, maybe some bad choice or some external circumstances over which you have no control, how many people in this room have hit some speed bumps in life, have failed at some things? Okay. All right? The rest of you are just lying. It's true. We all have those glitches in the radar screens of our lives where it goes way down. Those glitches in the graphs that each and every one of us is experiences the valleys of life. Right? We don't know whether homes will be there when we return or what the situations will be. We all experience those valleys in life, and we have experienced them, and they're probably not going to just magically disappear because we've been on this wonderful vacation. The valleys of life. I don't know how it is for you, but for me, the times that I've experienced the most growth in my life have been those times when I've been down in the valley. Not the mountaintop experiences, not the peaks, but the valleys. Now, what we need to do is take the lessons we learn when we're down in the valley and take them to the mountaintop experiences of life with us. It would be tragic indeed if you looked at the graph of your life and saw those failures and those mishaps and so on and didn't learn from those lessons. So learn quickly. That's what Paul was saying. And then, once you have learned quickly, move forward. Paul says, I press on. I move forward. Do you know that you cannot go backwards in time? You just can't do it. And God doesn't want you to do that. And you can't live in the past. Many of us get caught up in the mistakes of the past, and we're just really never able to move into the triumphs of the future because of our looking back. You know, one of the things I noticed, and this may be part of God's wonderful love for us, is that He created us to be beings moving forward. I mean, just, we'll do the, like, little kids, okay? Where are your eyes? Can you point to them? Well, this is a slow group this morning. Your eyes, where are they? They're in the front of your head. God didn't put them on the back of your head. Perhaps He put them on the front of your head so you can look forward.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay.
I should be back on.
Where are your eyes? Front of your head. Ears. Side of your head, but they mostly they point forward. Some of them a little bit further out than others, right? they point forward. Why? So you can hear the promises of God and move forward in life. Where are your feet? Which direction do they point? Forward. So you can walk forward into the future. How do your hands reach best? Mostly forward. So you can be moving forward. There's only one thing that's on the backside. And maybe even God is saying some things just need to be left behind. Learn quickly from your mistakes and move forward in life. Hurry up, Becky. Come on.
Oh,
thank you. So, as we move forward in life, we forget the things that lie behind us. And Paul is not saying there to just have like a memory loss, but to learn quickly from the mistakes. And the last, but certainly not the most, maybe the most important thing that that I've noticed about lives that are lived for extraordinarily, are lives that are lived for purpose beyond themselves. There has to be something, a willingness to live for a purpose beyond myself. There has to be something more important in life than me just being able to manipulate circumstances and control people and have things focus around the goals and aspirations of my life. Paul said that this way. He said that I'm looking for the purpose for which Christ has called me. In other words, his purpose in life was to find God's purpose for his life and to live for that purpose. You know how quickly life goes by? I mean, it seems kind of, this past week, like life goes on and on. life goes by rather quickly. You know how fast we're traveling through space right now? On this planet, we're going through space at about 60,000 miles per hour. Okay? And this world is spinning on its axis. Faster than the spin cycle of your washing machine, right? A few more spins. I mean, just look around you in the room here today. I didn't see any little kids here this morning, but so if there aren't any little kids, if you look around you in this room today, 50 years from now, just me. No, I'm kidding. I mean, sometimes we overdo this and sometimes we underdo it, but the fact of the matter is that we are all living, dying creatures. Life only lasts so long. So what? Seize the moment. Find the purpose. Grab those opportunities. Now, let me suggest along the way here, and I know we come from a variety of backgrounds, let me suggest along the way here that finding that purpose for your life might be, no, I'm sure, it would be quite a bit easier with God's help. Kind of like the little boy who was, you know, watching his dad build this fence rock by rock, and his dad wanting to kind of challenge him, he says, go over and get that big boulder. So the little boy goes over to grab this boulder that's about twice his size and pick it up, and he can't move it. And struggles against it, comes back to his dad, and his dad says, well, have you tried everything? He said, I tried everything. He said, no, have you tried everything? Oh, I'll go back. So he comes back, and he puts his back against it. He's mortaring in with his little feet and can't move it at all. And goes back to his dad and says, I can't move it. It can't be moved. He said, have you tried everything? I tried everything. Have you tried everything? Okay. Goes back, and he gets a big stick, and he gets it under, wedges it underneath the boulder and tries to push up with his shoulder, and he can't move it at all. He's pushing and struggling and pushing and struggling. He goes back to his dad. He says, it can't be done. I've tried everything. He says, have you tried everything? He says, I've tried everything. He says, I've tried everything. There's one thing you haven't tried. What is it? You haven't asked me for my help. You haven't asked me for my help. And maybe, just maybe, there may be some of us who have not asked God for his help in finding that purpose in life. I am convinced that God loves us, and I am convinced of that because I have seen his son who was crucified on our behalf. I have seen the love of God poured out in a way, a sacrificing way for all of humanity, and whoever would want to buy in on that deal is welcome. And he says, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, trying to figure out the purpose of life, trying to figure out what happens after life and so on. Come unto me, all of you, and I will give you rest and peace. You know, Jesus didn't come into the world to establish a religion or even to make a religion new. He came into the world so that he could restore a relationship with God. And I am so thankful that he did that. And I want to invite you today, if you haven't done so, to seek him and to seek his leading and guiding in your life and finding purpose. Seize the opportunity, and God will meet you at that point. When you do that, you find the value and the purpose and worth of life. If I was to take a big block of steel, and if I made that steel into, let's say, nails, that block of steel might be worth $50. If I took that same block of steel, instead of making it into nails, if I made it into knives, it might be worth $200. Well, instead of nails or knives, if I made it into needles, sewing machine needles, fine sewing machine needles, probably worth about $2,000. But instead of nails, needles, or knives, if I made it into fine Swiss watch parts, that same piece of steel would be worth about $2 million. What's the difference? The difference is what it's invested in. So you have to stop and ask yourself today, what am I invested in? The worth of life revolves around those things. And my prayer for you this morning and always is that you'll live an extraordinary life, that you'll seize the opportunities, and that you'll find the investment of your life with God's help. Wanted to share that with you this morning. Thank you. Let's, if I could ask you to come back up, we're just going to close by singing the last stanza of that, How Great Thou Art.
All right, let's sing that one.
Something like that, right?
And when I think that God is Son, not sparing, send him to die, I scarce can take it in. And I shall bow my burden gladly lay.
Something like that. Let's sing the chorus.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great.
About a blessing in biblical times is something that people gave to one another. And so if you want to just cup your hands and take this blessing and put it in your heart, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Go in God's peace. Have a great and wonderful day.
This wonderful service this morning. I hope that it's, yes, round of applause. Yes, in my life at the moment, I'm going through this very strange feeling of, I feel a bit emotional. This strange feeling of meeting people for a reason, and I met Paul and his wonderful wife Sue on first formal night, taking a stroll along the promenade with my colleague and friend Kyle. And for whatever reason it was that we were meant to meet, we did that night, and we've been speaking all week, but it was only on Friday night that I found out that Paul was a pastor. And of course, officially, we shouldn't all be here today. So I just think it's wonderful that we met when we did. We've been friends all week long, sharing and everything. And then it came to Friday night, and I was given the opportunity to meet the pastor, Paul, and to organize this for you this morning and to let you all share in something very unique here today on board this beautiful ship. I also wanted to bring up Doris, who's at the back. Some of you were with us last week for National Service, and Doris, another pastor, shared with me, and she just wanted to come up and say something. So thank you very much, Paul.
Be with you long, but it's just been a blessing to be here this week, and I was praying this morning very early and asked the Lord for just something special to share with us before we leave, and it comes from Psalms 91, and we know that a lot's going on all around us and Haiti, and mm-hmm. We were just so blessed when we found out about the storm that happened in Haiti, that we were right on the other side of the cliff.
Yeah.
You know, and when I heard all the murmurings about ready to go home and this thing and the next thing, I thought, but look how blessed we are. Mm-hmm. We were at Lopunny. Mm-hmm. If the wind had hit a little further, the mud could have slid on the side that we were. But God didn't allow that to be. And that just proved how God's mercy is for us, and that blessed us very much to see we were there just on the opposite side that God kept us. And so the psalms that I like to read is Psalms 91. And how many of you enjoyed the pastor? I received some nuggets. I'm going to move on. But Psalm 91 says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made thee, Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitations. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against that stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou tread.